of psychology and pop culture had a baby, they'd call it Shrink Tank.
A new paper reveals more intelligent people are quicker to learn and unlearn.
90% chance that there's some like weird animal out there.
Yeah. Stern's been doing this forever. And far more extreme.
From Nashville and Charlotte, this is the Shrink Tank Podcast.
When you hear about slavery for 400 years, for 400 years, that sounds like a choice. Like, you was there for 400 years and it's all of y'all? You know, like, it's like we're mentally in prison. I like the word prison because slavery goes too direct to the idea of blacks. It's like slavery, Holocaust Jews, slavery is blacks. So prison is something that unites us as one race, blacks and whites being one race. That we're one, we're the human race.
That voice you heard, obviously, is Kanye West. We'll be talking about him in our second segment. Welcome, everybody. If you're joining us for the first time, we give you a special welcome. If you're coming back for more, thanks so much for joining us again. I'm Dave Verhagen here in Nashville. We've got a great show for you. Our trending topic is Kanye West. Lots to talk about there in our second segment. But first, let's meet our Charlotte panel. Dr. Emma Kate Wright is here. Emma Kate, how are you?
Hi, Dave. I'm doing all right. Hope you are.
I'm great. Any news in your life?
No, I'm really just kind of enjoying actually having a spring this year because it's not like blazing hot from winter immediately. Like there's normally no in between. We get like a week of spring weather, but we've had like almost a month of spring weather.
And
it's
Frank,
been very nice.
Dr. Frank Gaskell's here. Frank, how are you feeling?
That's me, Dave. I'm feeling pretty good, and I have to tell you, I'm pretty excited because my son Maddox, who is a Fortnite expert, has started to stream on Twitch, which is pretty cool. And you can actually look at his gameplay. His username is Son of Vader Geek.
All right. On Fortnite. Hey, by the way, I've been playing Fortnite, the 50 versus 50 edition.
And so good.
And I've not come in lower than second place any game.
Wow. Yeah. That's awesome.
Do you have
dude.
To be over 50 to play in
Man.
That league?
Right.
It's yeah, the I am over 50.
The senior league.
I'm just obsessed with Fortnite. So great.
Yeah, it is worth getting obsessed about. That was Frank Gaskell. You'll be hearing more about him in our second segment when we talk about Kanye West. And great. Jonathan Hederle is here. He's our certified Asian who rounds out our panel. And Jonathan, you doing fine?
I am doing fine, Dave. You doing fine?
I'm doing fine. Thanks much.
I'm glad you do fine.
Well, each week, Jonathan trolls around the internet, and then he finds a great story of psychology in the news for our first segment that we call
Being Human.
Get this. People who think real America is decaying from within are more likely to believe conspiracy theories. New research has found evidence that conspiracy theories are associated with the belief that core American values are under siege. The study examined the role of system identity threat, meaning the perception that society's fundamental values are fading away because of social change. So people who agreed with statements such as, "In this country, there's a real America," distinct from those who don't share the same values, or agree with statements such as "America's greatest values are increasingly decaying from within," were also more likely to agree with statements such as "the media is a puppet for those in power, and nothing in politics or world affairs happens by accident or coincidence." System identity threat associated with conspiracy theories. Frank, as our resident paranoid psychologist, what do you make of these findings?
Well, I think all of the conspiracies are true, actually.
Okay.
You know, that jet fuel cannot melt metal. Like, you're aware of this, right? Right? You know that? No? Okay. This study is terrifying to me because it points out exactly what is happening in the United States right now. It also explains what was happening in Germany in the 30s. And this is a great quote from the study. They found that the perception of a society's fundamental defining values when they're under siege due to social change strengthens conspiratorial thinking and conspiracy theory endorsement. And I don't remember a time in history where I've heard so many conspiracies. And when you have the people in charge even promoting this stuff. There's no way to essentially disprove it. Facts become meaningless. And the one thing about this study I would like to know more about for these subjects is if you did a personality assessment of them, did they tend to be more fearful people? And also, is this controlled for education? But it shows how there's a grouping of people. They don't want change. They feel a threat from ethnic or racial change, that they dig into these conspiracies to hold on to this belief that the world was better. And it's really scary stuff. But the last thing I'll say about this, it does not explain UFOs or Bigfoot. Like, I don't think those conspiracies match up with the kind of people they're talking
about. Because they're real, right?
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly right.
Okay.
But ghosts are not.
No, they are.
It's interesting you said that because I love conspiracy theories or weird theories about Bigfoot and UFOs and Loch Ness Monster and things like that. I don't believe them, but I love them. And it makes my skin crawl to hear all the political conspiracy theories. Like those are creepy to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, this study is highlighting interesting psychological phenomenon. So there's a confirmation bias where essentially you seek out information that is going to confirm your beliefs. But then there's also something called the backfire effect where essentially any information that contradicts your beliefs will actually strengthen them. So this goes for all those flat earth believers. Like, I don't really know where that's coming from. And they're just kind of idiots. So
I saw a great image on the interwebs, and it was I think it's called Atlas. It's the man holding the earth on his back, and a guy recreated it as a flat earther, and he's in the same pose but holding a flat metal disc on his back. It's hilarious.
Yikes. It is fascinating stuff because I'm with you, Frank. I don't think I've ever heard as many conspiracy theories as I have recently. I think they kind of started back up during the Clinton era a little bit with all the conspiracies around Whitewater and Vince Foster being murdered in his office and all that kind of stuff. And then there was a lull. There was a little bit of it around 9/11. But now, man, it is like wildfire. It's like crazy stuff. Yeah. So when you say it's scary, I mean, you've already said a little bit of this, but what makes it scary to you?
Because you can't argue empirical facts. It's when you live in the land of conspiracy, facts don't matter. So you can just say whatever you want. And if somebody contradicts it, they say fake news or they say, yeah, I don't believe you. It's such a rigid mindset that you can't break it up. I don't know how to break that up.
And if somebody's part of, like, let's say they're in a role where they could speak to it with some authority, like they're a scientist or they're a, you know, political insider, then they get written off as part of the whole machine.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's no solid ground you can stand on. Everything's quicksand.
Crazy. All right. Well, let's bridge that gap to our trending topic. And by the way, if you want to write us or give us feedback or any opinion for any questions or comments, you can write us at feedback@shrinktank.com. We'd love to get your comments and we'll react to them in a variety of ways. So give us that feedback at feedback@shrinktank.com. Let's talk about our trending topic, which is Kanye West back in the news again. Let me just set this up by saying on the website shrinktank.com, our most popular post that we've ever done was really in our first year, and it continues to be the top producer in terms of clicks and hits. It is The Psychology of Kanye West. It is huge. And we internally would say we can count about three times a year where Kanye seems to go off the rails, and whether that is intentionally, unintentionally, we don't know. And we would get huge volume of hits from that kind of stuff. So he's back in the news again, saying some really wacky doodle things. And there's a whole lot of stuff around mental health, around issues of race and slavery and all kinds of things to talk about there. So there's plenty to talk about. I'm going to start with Emma Kate. Emma Kate, any just general thoughts about where things are with Kanye right now?
Well, so it's interesting because I feel like a lot of the wheels kind of came off for him really in November of 2016, because that was when he went into the hospital supposedly for dehydration, exhaustion, and he had to end his, I think it was the Pablo tour early. And now it's come out that actually he had plastic surgery. And he got addicted to opioids. And, you know, so I think we've kind of seen he's always had this sort of up and down in his personality. And, you know, it's almost like he goes through these phases where he's like, OK, I'm trying to, like, keep things in check. He's on a tight leash. And then all of a sudden he's like, nope, I'm going to do what I want. And right now, you know, this whole idea of free thought, you know, for those who aren't aware, he recently talked about slavery being a choice, which has obviously caused a lot of people, a lot of controversy there. And, you know, my concern is I have a hard time discerning whether or not I think he's obviously got a lot going on, but I have a hard time discerning how much of that is like a true potential mental health thing, along with, is this a marketing ploy? Like, I really hope it isn't, but I wouldn't put it past him and, you know, the Kardashian family to do something like that.
Frank, any opening thoughts?
Well, it's funny when I'll listen to some music that the young people around here teach me, and I'll like quite a bit of it. And then when I find out it's by Kanye, I'm thinking, oh wait, what? I like some of his music. That's weird. But the thing that makes me this is going to sound ridiculous, but I kind of think of him as Mozart, in that Mozart was doing things that nobody else was doing during his time period. He was crazy eccentric, devoted to his work, a perfectionist, was just into everything possible. And he strikes me as one of these brains that are going all the time, that are off the rails, edgy, very creative, but that artistic, not, I don't want to say mental illness, but that brain that is left of center. And I feel like that's kind of where he's at. That's the way I look at him.
Yeah, I could buy that. I think there's some complexity to it with him, but I definitely could buy that. Jonathan, how about you? Opening comments.
Yeah, that's an interesting take that Frank presented. I've actually thought a lot about Kanye and some parallels with Elliott Smith. And for those that aren't familiar with Elliott Smith, he was a singer-songwriter who eventually suffered from addiction, and there was a very controversial and questionable death of whether it was suicide or whether his ex-girlfriend stabbed him to death. But here's the interesting thing about Elliott Smith, where I draw the parallels. Very early on, his music was very somber, and he would use lyrics about drug addiction as a metaphor for like loneliness or disconnection, and he would do that in his early songwriting, and he had no substance abuse issues. And then he eventually developed substance abuse and addiction issues. And there's a part of me that thinks Kanye, very early on, the self-promotion, the God complex, it was much more of a branding and a way to really distinguish himself. And I feel like over time, it started to really permeate him, where he would lose a little bit more of a strong foundation of reality versus what was fabricated. That's kind of how I've always wrestled with what's going on with Kanye in those regards.
The other thing about him is it seems as if everybody who knows him personally, or maybe not everybody, but that he's charming and he wins people over, they find him very interesting. And I saw in 2006, Evel Knievel actually sued him. Did you guys know that?
No.
Yeah.
Nope.
Evel Knievel sued him because Kanye had a persona for this video called Touch the Sky, where he had the persona of Evel Knievel, but he called himself Evel Kanyeevil.
Wow.
Yeah. And, and what's crazy is, I know, right? Evel Knievel met with Kanye and sat down. And after the talk, Evel Knievel said, I liked him so much that I dropped the lawsuit.
Yeah. Well, that doesn't surprise me terribly much because and I'm not offering this as a diagnosis. So one of the things that is I think I feel strongly about, too, is we can't diagnose people from afar, but we can describe traits. So I don't know that he has a narcissistic personality disorder. I do know that he has narcissistic traits, or at least his public persona has those traits. But let's say that's true. People that are narcissistic can be incredibly charming. Let's say there's some other kind of mental illness, which again, I don't know, but let's say if it was a bipolar disorder or something like that, we know that there are times when people who are in hypomanic episodes can be incredibly charismatic and charming. So that kind of stuff actually fits for me, which is the bridge to the question I was going to ask. And that is, his wife has come out and said, look, get off of this idea of talking about his mental health and having mental health problems. He's an expressive guy and you have no right to say anything like that. Do you think that's true? Do you think that that us included, that we have no right to talk about or speculate even about his mental health questions? What do you think?
Well, you know, one of the things that I always think about with celebrities in general is that because they have chosen that path for their life, they have kind of opened the door to no longer have as much privacy. And so, you know, I don't know if it's necessarily our right to speculate, but people are inherently going to do that because they are such a public figure. In regards to, you know, saying whether or not he actually has a mental diagnosis, you know, I'm going to reiterate what you said. We can't do that because we don't actually know him. We don't know his full history, his background. We can only speak to some of the traits that he might show for some of these different disorders. But again, you know, I think overall, if you're a celebrity, you've opened that door. People are going to talk about you and they're going to even come from a place of concern. It's not always bad.
Well, and let's face it, the general public is doing this already with Kanye. And if psychologists and mental health professionals don't have a voice in the conversation, then we're really opening it up for people to have very erroneous and misinformation to draw from. So it's not even so much purely speculating on Kanye's mental well-being, but it's also making sure the conversation around people's understanding of what's being thrown his way is accurate and factual.
It's human nature. It is what we do.
Yep.
We describe, we observe, and I'd say as psychologists and therapists, that's on steroids.
That is true. And, you know, when we think about gossip, people gossiping about people on a local level, kind of among their friends, if we think about it from what purpose does that serve, other than it just, you know, if it's not just a tacky thing, it really, from a evolutionary or developmental standpoint, it serves the purpose of being cautionary tales and helping instruct people about how they should live and giving us feedback about what seems like it's going off the rails and what's within kind of the acceptable boundaries. That's really, you know, at its best when people are talking about other people, the purpose that we're at some deeper level trying to get to. You could make the same argument that to talk about this could just be mean and catty and spiteful even, but you could also make the point that to talk about it, at least in the way that we want to, can be helpful. And even though we don't know the guy and we're not going to presume to diagnose the guy, you could make the argument that there's something helpful and good about talking about these issues. So with that being said, do you think that you have kind of, I heard even in our opening, just freestyle, I heard a variety of theories or ideas. do you feel like you've got a sense of what's up? We have narcissistic traits. We have an admission of major substance abuse and dependency in the past, at least. We've got some trauma and loss. We've got some other things that look like just maybe mania, hypomania. Maybe that's just narcissism. Do you feel like you've got any sense of what's up with him? Anybody want to jump in there?
I feel like I have a general idea of what he's about. He the Art Institute of Chicago actually gave him an honorary doctorate, which is where he was in school. And they did it for shifting the cultural landscape, imagination, all this kind of stuff, which I agree with. Some of it's super bizarre. But the only thing I am sure of when it comes to Kanye is I have absolutely no earthly idea what he'll do next. And I think that's what's so interesting about him.
When I observe Kanye and get the backstory of his life and some of his creative output, it actually, I've had several clients over the years that share some of the similar traits that he exhibits that have been bipolar. And whether it was substance or trauma really being a catalyst for a manic episode, I've had guys where that mania has created some of the most phenomenal artistic output and connection of thinking in their life, but it also tends to create a pretty sustained pattern of a lot of collateral fallout, exhaustion, and then coming out of both in mania and out of it, some really questionable thinking and reality testing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm kind of in line with you, Jonathan, on that piece. Just even, I've actually been to a Kanye West concert, and
wow,
it was unreal. Like, this was back in his heyday at during the graduation album, and you know, all of my friends were like, "You're gonna go to a Kanye concert?" I was like, "Yeah, it's gonna be awesome." And it was such a phenomenal performance. He's so talented at what he does, but when I watch interviews with him, it's so fascinating because sometimes the level, the energy, it really does feel very much like a mania. And then he's very flat, and at other times, they're very calm and mellow and almost kind of sad. And so, you know, I think just to kind of reiterate, like, if we were going to say anything, again, just these traits, he would show a lot of these traits that are consistent with bipolar.
Yeah, and I don't know all the details of this, but this most recent thing with TMZ, he shows up at TMZ and yeah, inserts himself into the, I mean, that feels like it's something beyond narcissism. It feels like someone that's got really spinning thoughts. And again, we're not diagnosing the guy. We don't know. But that's sometimes when people are in a manic episode, or what we call a hypomanic episode, which is outside of the realm of normal mood, but it's an elevated mood, not quite mania. Somewhere in there, it looks a lot like that. And having been in Nashville for 2 years and having now seen a number of people that are artists, struggling artists, striving artists, some that have done well. I agree with you, Jonathan. That kind of creative brain often goes bipolar or things like it. That cyclothymia, which is a variant of that, seem to go with that often. So that wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, because I feel like there is definitely some narcissistic traits, and he's got trauma in his background. We know that. But I feel like when he's stable, he's able to manage and contain that in a way that he's really friendly and agreeable and personable. But it's when he's in one of those cycles, it would make a lot of sense that all of a sudden you would see that some of those narcissistic traits really just elevate to like a messianic complex.
Yep.
I watched that TMZ thing a couple times because and some of it was edited, of course, just for time, but you know, just him there and them kind of looking at each other, and then him starting going off about slavery, and the African-American guy who had the wherewithal, God bless him, to push back, and then Kanye's reaction to that, which was, "I'm sorry I hurt you," and kind of following him around. And it was somebody that was in a different state of mind. It wasn't just someone who is being narcissistic and I can stride in here and say what I want. It was someone that was in a different mood state. At least that's how it looked as an observer.
But do you guys know what where the name Kanye comes from?
I do not.
It is Swahili, and it means the only one. And his middle name is, anybody know it?
Amari.
Amari, which is Swahili for God the Highest. So name is the only one, God the Highest.
Wow. Oh,
man. I can relate to that because Jonathan in original Hebrew means gift from God. So I'm God's gift.
Yeah. Well,
I'm the Kanye West of Asians.
I think I believe in a different God than you do, literally.
You know, Dave Verhagen means easily breakable bones in Swahili. So
it does.
Yeah.
And do you know what Benicio del Toro means in Swahili, Dave?
It means Benicio of the Toro.
That is right. You speak Swahili. Very good.
That's it. So back on task here. The thing that we're saying is there does seem to be, and again, we are going to be clear about this. We don't know, but there does seem to be a mental health piece of this for him. And we do know that he was hospitalized at the time, said it was a breakdown, I think, and then later said my breakdown was a breakthrough. And we don't know his private life and what he's like and what this looks like. What we know is that we can count just from how our website tends to perform around this, that you can predict that a couple times a year, 2-3 times a year, you're going to have these moments. It's predictable. And that feels more like a cyclical, almost bipolar thing. So there's some things that kind of lead that way. If that's the case, then how are we to think about him as an artist, as a person? What's the best response?
Well, I mean, I feel like it kind of fits like the classic artist. I mean, truthfully, I feel like we've already kind of hit on this a little bit where there are these really creative souls have experienced a lot of pain, a lot of heartache. They've also typically had to overcome a lot of that. And so they're resilient to a certain extent. And, you know, I'm thinking back to November of 2016, where he had his breakthrough. You know, this was all right. So he was apparently dealing with opioid addiction, but it was also right around when his wife, Kim Kardashian, if I'm recalling correctly, was robbed at gunpoint in France. And so, you know, there's this sort of, you know, potential trigger or at least an extreme stressor that might exacerbate something like this. And it's about, okay, well, you know, if he is this artist and if, let's say, hypothetical, he's showing these traits that are characteristic of bipolar, then he fits most really interesting artists. Just their brain works differently and they're unique and they experience these dark, dark lows and high highs. And that is a really cool way for them to channel their thinking.
I mean, I think it's similar to what we would do with anybody, even in our professional roles, where somebody suspected there was a mental illness angle or people were asking us questions about somebody's overall well-being. Is like you can point out observations and make very loose connections without formally diagnosing. And then to me, it's really just accept the guy for who he is and what he is at whatever level of engagement and understanding you have of him. It's like, for me, if he's bipolar or not, it may add a different layer of understanding and complexity. But at the end of the day, I either like his music and I connect with it or I don't. And it's not until it's really validated or it becomes the centerpiece of conversation and disclosure on his part. It's just kind of like speculative. And then what do you think of the guy? And for me, I tend to vacillate back and forth between like, I think he's so creative. And other times I'm like, this guy is a train wreck and I don't know if I'd like want to be in the same room with him.
I hope that for Howard Stern's final interview before he goes off the air, that he manages to get Kanye West. That would be phenomenal. I would love to hear that.
We roll it all together for Frank here with Kanye and Howard. I will say this for myself. I think it doesn't diminish him at all as a person or as a performer. I think it could go a long way to actually destigmatizing if it went in a different direction. Some of my favorite people in my personal life have significant mental health struggles, and there's some of the
You're talking about me, aren't you?
Well, I was going to say.
There it is.
Not to name names, but his last name rhymes with Gaskell. among other people. And, you know, I think that's those are folks that I find them to be just fascinating, intriguing, but just also just very passionate, and the way that they live is often very different, but sometimes in a good way. My hope is that if we're right, rather than there be this, don't talk about him from a mental health standpoint, back off, there's nothing wrong, that if there is something, that he would embrace that and use his platform for good, and to say, look, this is me, this is what I'm dealing with, what I'm managing, and that I think could be something that could be very powerful.
And I agree with you, Dave, and I am going to throw this out there to everyone else. He made a very interesting comment recently about how he actually would not go to therapy, and that the world is his therapist, and that he essentially kind of just lets everyone in on what's going on with him. But I don't necessarily believe that per se, but, you know, I worry for him in the sense that, like, if he truly is, you know, experiencing something and he's not going to get professional help, then, you know, we're not going to get to have that positive moment.
Right. Well, you know, Kanye, don't. Okay, Kanye, don't go to therapy, but come on the Shrink Tank podcast.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Have a conversation with us, because if you feel misunderstood, let us understand you.
Yes.
Frank understands being misunderstood.
I mean, you get understanding, and you get understanding.
Everybody gets understanding. All right. Well, for questions or comments about our discussion with Kanye, we want you to write us at feedback@shrinktank.com. We look forward to hearing your feedback, your questions, your comments. We hope you'll shoot us a note. And our final segment is something that we call Doctor's Orders. These are things that we're personally enjoying in pop culture. And Emma Kate, what do you have?
Okay. Well, as listeners who are consistently listening, I tend to make really random recommendations sometimes, but this is something that I have really been enjoying, and it's an Instagram account called The Haley Cakes, and it's a baker in Austin, Texas, and she does all of these, like, really awesome creative cookie decorating, and I know it sounds so weird, but if you watch one of these clips, the videos of them decorating the cookies are the most relaxing things you will watch.
Okay, and so I think it is bizarre that you watch all these things because you can't eat anything you're watching.
No, I can't.
Oh, my gosh.
Mm-mm. No. But it's just so cool. It's really pretty. And
oh, boy.
I love it.
You know, you've heard of food porn. That's food torture porn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. Yeah. That's food torture porn. Yes, good job.
That. I could see that.
All right, Frank.
I am going to recommend something that you can pre-order. Comes out May 22nd, 2018, and it is Stephen King's new book, The Outsider. And I'm particularly excited about this book because it is a murder mystery, and he's been doing more of that recently, and he's very talented about it. But it again has this shocking ending, and I'm excited for my summer reads. And next week, I'll be recommending another summer read that I just really love.
All right, that's going to do it for this edition of the Shrink Tank Podcast. You can check out shrinktank.com for great articles and videos, and you can also find links to our Doctor's Orders products. You can follow us on Twitter @shrink_tank and like us on Facebook. For questions or comments, write us at feedback@shrinktank.com. Our producer and theme music composer is Sean Beck. For Emma Kate Wright, Jonathan Hederle, and Frank Gaskell in Charlotte, I'm Dave Verhagen in Nashville. Tell all your friends about us and make it a great week.
She don't believe in shooting stars, but she believe in shoes and cars. Wood floors in the new apartment. Coupe tour from the store's departments. You more like love to start. I'm more of the trips to Florida, order the orders. The water straight from a page of your favorite author, and the weather's so breezy.
Yay. Here I come.